here in the United States, we are not just dealing with one viral outbreak. We are dealing with multiple outbreaks. On August 4th, the Biden administration declared the growing monkeypox surge a national public health emergency. So far, there have been over 7,500 confirmed cases in the United States. And while there have been no recorded fatalities, we could be facing a crisis without the vaccines needed to protect the individuals most at risk. Now, this is on top of the ongoing coronavirus pandemic that is still running rampant out there. Currently, in the United States, we are averaging over 117,000 new cases and over 490 deaths a day. And if that is not enough, in New York State, the CDC is investigating a confirmed case of polio. Polio, y'all. This is the first confirmed case since 2013. New York health officials warn there could be hundreds of unconfirmed cases in the state and that this is just the tip of the iceberg. So joining me now is someone whose Twitter account makes me feel better at night, Dr. Isaac Bogoch. He is an infectious disease physician and scientist based out of the University of Toronto. All right, doctor, let's focus on the monkeypox outbreak first. The U.S. makes up just 4% of the world's population. But as of August 5th, the CDC's data says it accounted for over 25% of the world's monkeypox cases. What is going on? Why has the United States failed to really slow the spread of this virus?
Well, sadly, I think the United States was a bit slow out of the gate in terms of getting this under control. This is something where you've got to act fast, you've got to be decisive, and then recalibrate along the way. I think it's fair. I'm saying this with zero stigma, zero moralization, zero discrimination whatsoever. But we know that the vast majority of cases are in the men who have sex with men community, especially in areas outside of countries where this virus was initially known to infect individuals. And certainly a very focused, rapid, tailored public health response is in order. You're starting to see the United States and the various states get their act in gear and get vaccines out and public health campaigns rolled up. But that took a bit of time, and I think other parts of the world were a little bit faster.
So while monkeypox is spreading, we're also still in the midst of the coronavirus pandemic. It has a kind of here we go again feel to it, you know? So why do we keep facing these outbreaks? Like, what are we not learning, essentially?
Yeah, I mean, if we take a step back and look at the 30,000-foot view, you think all the way back to 2003, you had SARS-1. Then 2008, you had H1N1. In 2014, you had the Ebola virus outbreak in West Africa, which is thousands of miles from where Ebola outbreaks were previously known to exist. 2015, you had Zika virus, MERS, Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome in South Korea. In 2018, COVID, monkeypox. Like, you're starting to see a pattern here. Right, we're starting to see a lot of these what we call emerging and re-emerging infectious diseases, and a lot of this is a result of, well, many factors. One is humans are encroaching on environments where these viruses have existed, and there's more humans in contact with these viruses. Some of these viruses are transmitted by insects like Zika or dengue. Mm-hmm. And with global climate change, you're starting to see the expansion of the home range of these mosquitoes and other insects that transmit these viruses, putting more people at risk. And obviously, we're a very mobile world. People travel, people move. So you can have an infection that emerges on one side of the globe, and then that can travel to the other side of the globe in 24 hours and start an outbreak there. So there's just a lot of factors that are happening, which is why we're seeing more and more of these emerging and re-emerging infections more commonly, unfortunately.
I didn't even think about the fact that climate change is bringing us these terrible mosquitoes that are and other insects that are bringing these ridiculous viruses. It is all connected, as we like to say. Okay, so there's COVID, there's monkeypox, but now there's polio in New York. Now, I thought we had got a vaccine for polio. We were done with this. Why are new cases of polio popping up in the United States?
Let me just be clear, Doc.
People at home need to know it was declared eliminated in 1979. What is going on?
Yeah, this is a shame. So there still is polio in certain parts of the world. There absolutely is. And this is a virus that we certainly can eradicate. We have the tools to get this under control. There was a case of polio in New York State, and it's unfortunate because there's under-vaccinated communities and many people remain unvaccinated. Remember, this vaccine has been available in the United States since 1955. It's coming up 70 years that this vaccine, free, safe, widely available, and effective, has been available. There's no excuse to have polio circulating. I think it's extremely important, if people remain unvaccinated, to go out and get the vaccine. Remember, about 1 in 200 cases can result in paralysis, and that's often irreversible. So this is tragic, and this is something that we certainly can get under control and should get under control immediately.
Get vaccinated, folks. Okay, doctor, before I let you go, you talked about all of these factors that were, you know, kind of bringing these viral outbreaks to us that were out of our control. One could argue climate change is within our control, but that's another panel. What can we as individuals, as a society, do to combat these viral outbreaks? What is within our control to do about this?
That's a great point. So I think it's important to recognize these are global issues, not just regional issues. Yes, of course, we have to act regionally, but we also have to think globally. We really need to focus on bolstering capacity, both clinical and public health capacity, especially in low-income countries where we know a lot of these viruses are emerging. A, it's the ethical and moral thing to do is to help those around us who are less fortunate, but B, it has additional knock-on positive effects for the rest of the world. If we can detect these emerging viruses more rapidly, we can stop these outbreaks and prevent pandemics and larger epidemics. So we need to invest in public health and clinical capacity in low-income countries. We also need better global coordination and communication so that we can have a more coordinated response when we start to see these outbreaks. That way, it will impact fewer people and cost less money. COVID-19 has cost millions and millions of lives and trillions of dollars. And I think it's in everyone's best interest to prevent this from happening ever again.
Dr. Isaac Bogoch, he has provided us the prescription for what we need to do. Thank you very much, sir.
My pleasure. Have a great day.